mystery surrounds what exactly was the object the U.S. jet shot down over Alaska. What's up, podcast listeners? Welcome to today's show, and that's exactly what we're going to get into today. I know that a lot of people have been talking about the first balloon that came over, and then there was a second object that came over, apparently from China. They don't know. They're not being transparent with us. Of course, what a big surprise there. You know, so I decided to do a little bit of digging myself and try and find the information, as I always do, so that I can make up my own mind with the facts and just go from article to article and figure out exactly what's going on. And I'm going to give you my opinion on the whole matter. We're not going to talk about the balloon as much as we are what China is up to exactly. And I have a few articles here that I'm going to read to you. And then after you get to hear all the facts and after you hear the articles, you can make up your own mind and I'll give my opinion on it. And then after you hear everything that I have to say, you can make up your own opinion and tell me what you think. So we're going to get started here with the first article. And this article is from The Observer, and hat tip to Lauren Aretani. Questions remain a day after the U.S. government said it shot down a high-altitude object the size of a small car along with the northeastern Alaskan coast on Friday afternoon. Though efforts by the Navy, Coast Guard, and FBI are underway to recover the object, officials had yet to identify its owner or purpose on Saturday. The object was flying at an altitude of 40,000 feet, about the same level as commercial planes, and was traveling about 20 to 40 miles per hour before it was struck down. Officials say the object had flown over parts of Alaska, but was headed toward the North Pole before it was struck down. American radars first identified the object's presence around 9 p.m. Alaska time on Thursday evening. A U.S. warplane ultimately shot it down about 1:45 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on Friday. Joe Biden briefly told reporters on Friday afternoon that the takedown of the object was, quote, a success. But the president did not offer any further details. Yeah, and that's why are they just not being honest with this thing? And if it wasn't for that woman in Montana seeing that first balloon, I don't think they would have mentioned anything about that either. This administration and this military and our government, they're just super sneaky all the time, man. So, you know, you can't trust anything these people say. I'm going to continue on with the article. At a White House press briefing on Friday, the National Security Council spokesperson John Kirby said the U.S. military brought the object down, quote, out of an abundance of caution. Once spotted, officials quickly deemed the object a threat to civilian air traffic and ordered Alaska airspace to be temporarily closed. I don't believe that. I don't believe they took it down because it was a threat to air traffic. You can make assumptions after assumptions, but if this administration, if these people don't understand by now that if you're not transparent with people, if you're not open to people and honest, then that's how conspiracy theories happen. Because if you don't come out and you give honest answers and you give the answers people are looking for, then people are just going to assume you're lying and they're going to start thinking stuff up in their head. And apparently this administration hasn't got that by now. And I just find it really bizarre how they let one balloon traverse the entire country and shoot it down after its mission was completed. And the other one they nuke out of the sky within 15 minutes. So I guess that just goes to show that the first balloon was a real mess up on their part. And they probably didn't even plan on telling anybody about it, but until that woman seen it. I'm going to continue with the article. Fox News reported Saturday that an unnamed but senior U.S. official confirmed to the network that the object was not detected until it entered American airspace. The object, shot down in territorial waters, was unmanned, officials said. The object's destruction in Alaska came after a tumultuous week for the Biden administration. Yeah, I would say. That was a disaster. It just showed extreme weakness, extreme incompetency, just the worst of the worst. It's been a tumultuous week for the Biden administration, which ordered the military to shoot down a high-altitude balloon from China over the Atlantic Ocean on February 4th. Officials have yet to publicly give further descriptions of the object that was traveling over Alaska besides its size, altitude, and speed. Still, officials have been speculating in various reports about the nature of the object. Of course they're speculating, because the people that know what this object is, the people that seen it, the people that have photographs of it, they're not being honest and transparent. So, of course, people are going to start speculating. One official told ABC News that the object was cylindrical and silverish gray and gave the balloon-like appearance of floating without any sort of propulsion. Another official from the Department of Defense told the New York Times that the object broke into pieces when it hit the frozen sea. After the Chinese balloon was shot down, images showed what appeared to be shreds of materials as if it was fished out of the ocean. Brigadier General Pat Ryder of the Pentagon told reporters on Friday that officials, quote, have located a significant amount of debris so far that will prove helpful to our further understanding of this balloon and its surveillance capabilities. From the size comparison given by officials, the object that was flying over Alaska appears to be much smaller than the Chinese spy balloon. The confirmed balloon was described as being as big as two or three buses rather than a small car like the object over Alaska. The Alaska object was also flying at a lower altitude than the Chinese balloon, which had an altitude of 60,000 feet, much higher than the level of commercial air traffic. The Republican Senator Lisa Murkowski of Alaska told NBC News Friday that she was concerned about the threat posed by objects over her state's airspace. Quote, quite honestly, the first line of defense is Alaska, Murkowski said. If it comes into Alaska airspace, if it comes into Alaska waters, we need to act. We need to send the message and we need to be clear and unequivocal that we do not tolerate this. Well, sorry, Murkowski, you ain't getting that from Biden. That dude let that balloon just float right on through the country and then took that thing down in the ocean. And that's that. Its mission was complete. And, you know, they seem to, I think they started, they said that, oh, they were jamming its signal the whole time. Folks, these people aren't honest about anything. How do we know that? This is what happens when you just have a dishonest administration, man. So you know what? We're going to do the work ourselves. We're going to dig into this. We're going to dig into this whole thing. And I'm going to give you my opinion on what's happening right now with between China and the United States and China and sending these balloons and these objects and these aircrafts out. And then you can make up your own opinion. But either way, we're going to dig into this, into these articles, and we're going to figure out exactly the direction China is heading right now and most likely where we're heading too. The articles continued. Blinken said the spy balloon was an irresponsible act and a clear violation of the U.S. sovereignty and international law that undermined the purpose of this trip. Chinese officials have apologized and maintained that the balloon was, quote, a civilian airship used for weather research that went off course due to limited self-steering capabilities and that its entry into U.S. airspace was unintended. I mean, yeah, and you know what? What's the Biden administration going to do about it? What are they doing about this, you know? It's like, man, they're so weak. This administration's so weak. Our generals are so weak. Our military leaders are so weak. It's no wonder why China sent another one. You know, why not? I'm telling you, folks, wait till we get into these other articles and you'll see what I'm talking about. Where are we at here? Let's finish with this article. Meanwhile, U.S. officials say the balloon was carrying equipment that was capable of intercepting and geolocating communications. It was clearly for intelligence surveillance and inconsistent with the equipment on board for weather balloons, a senior State Department official said on Thursday. It had multiple antennas to include an array likely capable of collecting and geolocating communications. U.S. officials say the balloon was part of a fleet that has been used to collect intelligence in more than 40 countries on 5 continents. They maintain that balloons went into U.S. airspace at least 3 times during Donald Trump's presidency and twice so far during Biden's. Despite the technology carried by the balloon, the Pentagon said the balloons do not give China any intelligence collecting capacity beyond existing technology, such as satellites. You know, and then, you know, towards at the very bottom of the article, they just had to mention about the three going through Donald Trump's administration. And that's a whole situation in itself, folks, that we're not going to dig too deep into today. But at the moment that the Pentagon came out and said that there was 3 balloons that came during the Trump administration, it got debunked by, you know, 2 senior officials during the Trump administration, pretty high ranking officials. Dan Ratcliffe, I think, was one, or John Ratcliffe. I think he would know if there was spy balloons traversing our country during the Trump administration. And he said absolutely not. And then Mark Esper, one of the top-ranking generals, I think he was. He even said he don't recall any balloons coming through the Trump administration. So who are you going to believe, folks? Who are you going to believe, the government or two high-ranking U.S. officials that really have no reason to say yes or no? I mean, they're not currently serving in the White House or anything, so why would they have to lie about something stupid like that? So, you know, it's whatever, but now China is just getting ballsy now. China's just having their way with Joe Biden at the moment. So this is the kind of stuff that creeps me out, because the very first thing that I thought of when I seen that China had sent another object into United States airspace, but a different type of object, is China's sending a message to the Biden administration. China's sending a message. They're accomplishing two things. They're sending a message to the Biden administration, basically saying, yeah, we did this. What are you going to do about it? And the second one is they're testing their response. They're testing to see what our military does. They're testing to see what Joe Biden does. They're testing to see how the society reacts. They're testing to see everything. And it's working, because the Biden administration on the first balloon failed. And then on the second one, it blew it right out of the sky. But it's like, don't you think that's a little too late, man? And then it also goes to show that the first excuse they made for not blowing the first one out of the sky was all BS. So what I think is happening, ladies and gentlemen, is China is surveying our country so that they have intelligence on their best method of attack. Because there's no way you're sending a spy balloon that just happened to be traversing over every single secret top secret military base that we have in our country, over remote locations that really nobody knows about except for military officials. I mean, when you look at the map, this thing of the path that this balloon took, I mean, it literally goes over one military base after another, from one end of the country over to the other. And then the Biden administration blows it out of the sky with a $70,000 AXM-9 Sidewinder missile, and its mission was complete. So it's like, you know, a complete failure from my eyes. Obviously, the other side's not going to admit that. But let's dig into a little bit. I have some other articles here that kind of cement my theory on what's going on here. Personally, I think we're heading into major, major conflict with China. I think we're heading into a global conflict. You can call it World War III if you want, but that's what I think's happening, because we have Russia and Ukraine fighting a war, which we're supplying everything to Ukraine. So we're whistling our way right into that war on that end. And then because of that response and how what we're doing over there, China's wanting to invade Taiwan. And China knows that we are busy with Ukraine. And we are, folks. We are, because even Republicans, you know, the war hawk Republicans on this side, they're gung-ho about supplying unlimited arms and money to Ukraine indefinitely until end of time, I guess. I don't know what this means. I guess until what? Ukraine defeats Russia? Until Ukraine gets Crimea back? I don't know. If Ukraine would have just been honest to begin with and said, look, we want to use the United States for their money and their weaponry so that we can take Crimea back, you know, they would have had, I don't know, at least they would have been honest. But doing it this way, man, you're just continually dividing the country, man. You have half the country that supports this, and you have half the country that don't. I, for one, don't. Why? Because I think it's sidestepping into World War III. That's why. And somehow the United States always manages to get ourselves into world wars. And it's like, it doesn't have to be this way, folks. Like, I get men have been conquering men since the beginning of time, since the dawn of man. You know, you've had tribes conquering other tribes for thousands of years. And they even have dug up skeletons, you know, 50,000-year-old skeletons, where the skeleton has an arrowhead in its rib cage. So yeah, I understand the nature of human beings. I understand that, you know, we have this unquenchable thirst to kill each other. But It doesn't have to be this way, not like this. And it's so senseless, man, because it always seems like the politicians and the wealthy people and the elites, they never have to go and die for their countries. They never have to go fight in any of these wars, but they always benefit from the wars and they never have to lose any loved ones or suffer or sacrifice anything. So it's like it's the common man, the middle class, the lower class, you know, it's us that have to suffer every time these wars happen, like Vietnam. And luckily they got rid of the draft because that was disgusting, man. The draft was probably the worst thing that you could ever do to a nation's people. It absolutely, absolutely disgusting. And I'm glad that they got rid of that because what that was about was absolutely wrong. You drafted young men to go fight in a war that you got into, and these men didn't even want to go, so you forced them to go and get killed. I mean, just so sad, dude. So sad. Anyways, I digress on that. I want to kind of explain why I have the opinion I have about what China is up to right now and why they're sending these balloons over. And why are they building their military at an astronomical pace? Folks, I know you're not hearing much about this anywhere else, but China has been building its military up for a while now. And not just like normal rebuilding or just not just normal building. They're building their military up to like some serious levels. Way, way much more complex and way bigger than we are right now. I mean, they're building ships. I mean, they're building a battleship. That they're building battleships, they're building aircraft carriers, they're building everything, military bases, and they're building satellite stations in Antarctica. Yes, China is in Antarctica right now. China is in Antarctica, and I found this article today, actually. I had to dig real deep to get this one. And The article is dated February the 11th, so it was dated for today, and it's Pakistan Defense, hat tip to Nan Yang, and this article came out at 12:55 p.m. today, and it's titled, China Building New Satellite Station in Antarctica. While U.S. was looking up at China's inconsequential spy balloon, Beijing signaled a more strategic move on the South Pole. China's Taishan Station in Antarctica, China Aerospace Science and Industry Corporation, KASIC for short, had been selected to build a new ground station in Antarctica to serve China's National Satellite Ocean Application Service, the NSOAS. Such news reported on February 2nd might have ordinarily set off alarm bells in Washington, but the Americans were too busy watching the large Chinese spy balloon drift over North America. Boom. Could that be it? Could China had sent that balloon as a distraction for whatever reason, distracting the American people? Well, it didn't work for me because I already knew what they were doing. I already knew. Every time China does something like this, it's not for no reason, folks. There's always a reason for these people doing stuff like this. And them just telling Joe Biden that it's just a weather balloon that blew off course while this thing had obviously was maneuverable and it was the size of three school buses. And Joe Biden's just like, oh, okay, yeah, I believe you. But we still got to take it down, so I apologize. We're going to have to take it down over the ocean, but we'll wait. We'll take it down while it's over the ocean. You know, so, you know, I apologize. I hope you got to finish your mission, though, and you got everything you needed. That's what it seemed like you said, anyways. The article continues. Since 2002, China has launched 8 ocean observation satellites into orbit for various purposes, including oceanographic analysis, resource exploitation, the study of coastal ecology, and disaster monitoring. A 9th is scheduled to be launched this year. The new Antarctica ground station will facilitate the transmission of data from these satellites. The new antennas and receiving terminal will be built at China's Zhongsheng Scientific Research Base, also called A Station, which is located in East Antarctica near Pride's Bay, facing the Indian Ocean. Zhongsheng is one of 5 Antarctic research stations managed by the Polar Research Institute of China. In order of establishment, they are the Great Wall Station, the Zhongsheng Station, the Kunlun Station, the Taishan Station, the 5th Antarctic Station. Working name is Victoria Land Permanent Base. And that was built, that was the latest one. That was in 2022 on Inexpressible Island. So Inexpressible Island was named for the inexpressibly miserable winter spent there by members of the Robert Falcon Scott's Terra Nova expedition in 1912. Zhongsheng, Kunlun, and Taishan are located in the Australian Antarctic Territory, which occupies about 42% of the continent. Inexpressible Island is located in New Zealand's Ross Dependency, which includes the entire Ross Sea, including most of the Ross Ice Shelf, and bordering coastal and inland territories in a wedge running to the pole. So, like, is China like building all these, you know, they call them satellite stations, but are they bases? Are they strategic bases that China's building in Antarctica? Think about that, folks. You know, no one ever thinks about Antarctica. But during the World War II, the Nazis and Hitler was actually trying to build bases up in Antarctica, but and I do believe they might just get the supply. There were serious supply chain issues and the cost of the war. That was when the Americans joined. And the cost of the war was just too much for them to waste supplies sending up to Antarctica. So it kind of, I think it canceled. I don't think they've ever finished anything up there during World War II. But here we got China that's been building stuff up there for years now, for years. And is there any oversight of what they're building up there? I mean, is our American military doing anything about that? Do we have any bases up there in Antarctica? No, this is the kind of stuff I'm talking about. So China just does all this stuff. I mean, they play our American politics like fools, man. They play our military like fools. And frankly, it's because our military leaders, they are fools. Some of the stuff they do are fools. Folks, some of our generals never seen active combat, never seen any kind of live combat. You know, they went straight from West Point right into officer school. So it's like, I mean, it's just our military is so weak right now, man. And I think China sees it. I think China sees it, and China's taking advantage of the moment. They're taking advantage of Joe Biden and who's running our country, and they're walking all over us, and they're building up their military. They're building military bases in Antarctica that they call satellite stations, and, you know, they're getting ready, folks. That's what I think, okay? That's my opinion. I think they're getting ready for something big. I think they're getting ready for conflict. I think they feel like how I feel, and I feel like it's inevitable. It's inevitable that, once again, mankind is going to be getting into another global conflict, unfortunately. This article continues. Chile, Argentina, Norway, the UK, and France also claim Antarctic territory, but none of these claims are recognized under the Antarctic Treaty, which all of them, as well as the US, China, Russia, and 45 other countries, have signed. 12 countries have research stations on King George Island. And Article 4 of the Antarctic Treaty reads, no acts or activities taking place while the present treaty is in force shall constitute a basis for asserting, supporting, or denying a claim territorial sovereignty in Antarctica, or create any rights of sovereignty in Antarctica. No new claim or enlargement of an existing claim to territorial sovereignty in Antarctica shall be asserted while the present treaty is in force. The equal importance, Article 1 states that Antarctica shall be used for peaceful purposes only. There shall be prohibited, inter alia, any measures of military nature, such as the establishment of military bases and fortifications, the carrying out of military maneuvers, as well as the testing of any type of weapons. The present treaty shall not prevent the use of military personnel or equipment for scientific research or for any other peaceful purpose. Wait a minute. The present treaty shall not prevent the use of military personnel or equipment for scientific research or for any other peaceful purpose? What? That's crazy. So I knew that they had some kind of treaty up there because basically Antarctica was just like free reign. It was like nobody really owned it. It didn't really belong to anybody. So these countries, these 45 other countries, got together and they were like, look, you know, let's use Antarctica for scientific research. I mean, folks, it's probably the most miserable place on the planet. and you can't really do anything up there because there's nothing up there. And that's one of the reasons why the Nazis failed in World War II, was they're just getting the supplies there to build anything was impossible. You know, life up in Antarctica is unsustainable as we know it, as humans. Humans cannot exist up in Antarctica. We just can't. It's out of our, that's like, you know, humans can live in a desert. You know, they can, you know, they can run water. They can get water out there. Look at Egypt. All they needed was the Nile, and they figured out how to farm in the desert. So same thing with Antarctica. And it looks like China is building base after base after base up there, but they call them satellite stations. So, and one more thing that nobody has, that nobody's been talking about, which was another article that I found, which is going to dig in even more about why I think China is planning for a global conflict. And I had, so I have an article here also dated February 11th, a hat tip to M. Dowling, and it's by the Independent Sentinel. And the article reads, as a Chinese balloon sauntered in the sky over 40 countries, green laser shot down over Hawaii. We now know the lights probably came from a Chinese satellite. Yeah, so there was these green lasers that were shooting down into the Hawaiian Islands. Yeah, like, what's that all about? So I read, I kind of hinted on this article a couple days ago, but I didn't really dig in too deep until I started reading about this second object, and then one thing after another, I started going down the rabbit hole of exactly what's going on here and why I think China is preparing for global conflict, and I ran across this article about these lasers. No one even discussed these lasers. I bet no one even knows about this. So that's why I found this article to be very, very interesting and very persuasive in my opinion of China wanting and preparing for global conflict. The article continues, the mysterious green lasers. On January 28th, the same day a suspected Chinese balloon was detected by the U.S. off the coast of Alaska, a camera watching the night atop a mountain in Hawaii caught a series of green laser beams darting across the sky, lasting a matter of seconds, just as it turned 2 a.m. local time. Footage from the camera caught the bands arcing left to right, footage shows. While the owners of the camera initially supposed it was a NASA mapping satellite, the U.S. Space Organization had said this was not them, suggesting it may have been the Chinese. They originally thought it came from NASA, but it looks like it came from the Chinese Communist Party satellite. The lasers seem to be from Chinese Docky-1 AEMS satellite, which stated use of atmospheric environmental monitoring. Docky-1 uses an instrument similar to the NASA ICSAT-2 satellite. While everyone worries about a balloon, we have a few hundred Chinese satellites over us that can see far more detail than the balloon. The satellite was conducting atmospheric studies, spewing carbon emissions. They should do that in China. China, this is a quote from Twitter. China is shining green lasers down to Earth from space from their satellites. This was near Hawaii. This doesn't seem good. Yeah, that doesn't seem good. And nobody's talking about that. Like, what is going on here, folks? We got green lasers coming from Chinese satellites now, satellites owned by the Chinese Communist Party, shooting down on Hawaii. Hawaii, folks, you know what Hawaii is, right? You don't remember Pearl Harbor? Hawaii was a massive strategical naval base that was our ticket to our major naval battles. It was a major naval hub for all our ships, a refueling hub, an ammunitions hub. I mean, that's why they attacked Pearl Harbor, because they knew that. That was a strategic attack for them to get us involved in the war. It did two things. It destroyed a lot of our ships, caused a lot of damage to one of our biggest naval ports in the world, and it drug us into World War II. So here it is. On the same day, there's a Chinese spy balloon everybody's paying attention to. You have China breaking ground for a new satellite base in Antarctica. At the same time, there's lasers coming from a Chinese Communist Party satellite, a CCP satellite, shining down on a random spot in China or in Hawaii, that just so happened to be caught by these people with a camera. See, that's why I always say, folks, I always act like there's cameras everywhere, because there is. When you go out in public, you have to be under the indication that you're being watched by a camera, that you're being filmed by something or someone. There's always cameras everywhere now. And I think that's why we think there's a lot more crazy stuff happening, is because it seems like everything's on camera now and people can see it, and then it gets put on social media and then everybody sees it. So I don't know. That's just a theory. That's just a theory of mine, but I digress. We'll save that for another show. But yeah, so we got green lasers coming from a CCP satellite down on Hawaii. Why are they beaming lasers at Hawaii? Okay, that's two. And like I said, they're building bases that they call satellite bases or satellite depots in Antarctica, which they have six of them now. They're ramping up massively their military, building ships. I think they're putting out a ship like once every 3 months. They're putting out a major battleship in China. What else are they doing? I'm telling you, folks, that's this whole show was my way of explaining to you why I think China is preparing for global conflict. And that's it. And what are we going to do about it? I don't know. But we better be ready. And we're not ready. We're not ready, guys. I've said that about the Ukraine-Russia war. I've been saying that about our military for 2.5 years now. And even when Trump was in it, you know, Trump funded the military great, and the military was going great. But again, we just did not have the leaders, man. We do not have leaders like we used to have. You know, the Pattons, the General Pattons, they're gone, man. They're gone. I mean, look, there was a freaking spy balloon traversing our whole country before we shot it down over the Atlantic Ocean. And then China gets upset with us. I mean, the nerve of these people. And look, so like I said, I think we're whistling our way into a massive global conflict. And I'll go ahead and say it. I think we're walking right into World War III, ladies and gentlemen. But all right, that's all I got for today's show. I just wanted to point that out. I hope it's explained a lot, and I hope it kind of gives you an idea of what we're dealing with. I hope it, you know, you are informed now. I think you're informed with what we need to know. And if I find anything more on this, and I'm going to keep digging, folks, I'm going to keep digging. If I find any more on this, I'm going to give it to you guys. I'm going to be honest with you guys. I'm going to give it. There hasn't been a whole lot happening with the Ukraine-Russia war, so I want to keep you updated with that as well. But Zelensky did ask for F-16s from Europe, and Europe gave him the big middle finger and told him no, because that's an extreme escalation in war, and it is. You know, putting fighter jets into this conflict over Ukraine and Russia is just a massive, massive escalation, and it's already escalating. They haven't got any of our tanks yet. I think I did an episode of exactly why they're not going to be getting the Abrams tanks for a while, and that's because the defense contractors still have to make them from scratch. So Zelensky's not going to be getting Abrams tanks for a long time, ladies and gentlemen. So this war, our leaders, our military members, and all the politicians and people that support this war, they have no idea what winning looks like. They have no idea what an exit strategy looks like. All they keep saying is whatever they need for however long they need it. And there you go, folks. So plan on another Afghanistan and another Iraq war for the next 20 years with Russia and Ukraine. And while we are diminishing our military equipment, it seems as if China is quadrupling theirs. So you guys do the math there. You guys put two and two together and see what you come up with. And I assure you, it's probably going to be the same thing I come up with, and that is global conflict in the near future. So thank you, folks, for tuning into today's show. I'll keep you updated with this. I'm working on a website right now because I want to be able to upload my shows to the website. I want you guys to be able to comment and speak with me. I want it to be like a main hub for us. I want it to be like our freedom base, our liberty base, where we can go, we can hang out, we can leave, you know, we can blog about certain things. You guys can ask me questions. I can talk back with you. I'll answer any questions that you have. I'll read all the comments that you leave. And also, I want to be able to upload these articles to that website. I don't know exactly what goes into that as far as like copywriting and third-party entities and stuff, but I'll figure that out. But I am working on a website right now, and so that's going to be pretty cool. We're getting serious, folks. We're getting serious here. So I just wanted to do this quick little episode for you about the Chinese, the second object they found, or they blew up in China. And then also I wanted to connect a couple dots on that and what I think is happening. But thank you guys for tuning in. Make sure you share the show with your friends and family. And thank you guys so much for the likes. Thank you for the comments. Thank you for the subscribers. Thank you guys. And just keep doing it. Keep asking people to subscribe. And make sure you tell these people that it's free. It doesn't cost any money to subscribe. So, you know, tell your friends and family to subscribe to my show. Subscribe to this podcast. And let's get our voices out there, folks. Let's get our voices big. Let's get big and powerful so that we got a fighting chance in this battle we're heading into. And maybe we can change the direction this country's heading into. So thanks again for tuning into today's show. And you guys have yourself a good day. Oh, and enjoy the Super Bowl, ladies and gentlemen, if you're listening to this today, which it is currently Saturday at 5:50 p.m., I know the podcasters, and they don't like giving times for some weird reason. I don't know why. I think that probably has a lot to do with post-editing and stuff. But it is not Super Bowl time yet, so by the time you listen to this, it may be over already. However, I say Eagles are going to win, so let's go Eagles. But nonetheless, I don't have a dog in the fight, but nonetheless, you guys just have yourself a good time, and it seems like football is the only thing that unites us anymore, and that's great. At least we have one thing left. That the leftists haven't tried to, well, they did try to destroy it, but they haven't destroyed it yet. So at least we got football going for us to unite this country. You guys have a good time. You stay safe and tune in for the next show. You guys have a good weekend. Bye-bye.